Hello, everybody. Thank you very much for coming. Do you, is it working? Do you hear me?
Yes.
Okay. I'm Mato Kasaji, Human Rights Officer from the United Nations Office of the High Commissioner for Human Rights.
Sir.
I'm working with Special Rapporteurs, particularly on the right to water and sanitation and the right to adequate housing. So today, Catarina De Albuquerque, Special Rapporteur on the Human Rights Reserve during Drinking Water and Sanitation, and Ms. Leilani Farha, Rapporteur on the right to adequate housing, will share with you their views on their three-day visit to Detroit to learn more about the impact of current large-scale water disconnections on the human rights to water and sanitation and the right to adequate housing. So they will present their views in 1 minute, but after that, you will have opportunities to ask questions to both of them. But I'd like to ask you two things. One, because as we can see, there are many people here, so could you restrict just to one question per person? If we have more time, we will go back to you. And I am sorry to say this, but colleagues from civil society organizations or other organizations, I mean, not from the press, this is opportunity for media people to ask questions because we have already had a lot of dialogues with you and we will continue to have dialogues with you. So please give chance to media people. Thank you very much.
If you could please give your name when you start.
And spell.
And spell. Yeah, you're right.
or no, what? Us.
Yes, when you're
speaking. The
rapporteurs. And the press release is available here. Sorry.
You will get the press release, and because my name is very, it's like the town, like the city in New Mexico.
Please say it and spell it slowly, though, for the cameras.
Okay. Good afternoon, and thank you for being here. My name is Catarina, Catarina De Albuquerque, like the town, Albuquerque. And this is Leilani Farha, Leilani,
L-E-I-L-A-N-I, last name is Farha, F-A-R-H-A.
And we are sharing with you our conclusions, recommendations, our views after this three-day visit to Detroit. We will go back and forth, so I will refer to some things. Leilani will then comment on other things, then it will come back to me and then back to her, so that you know we will be playing ping pong among each other. Good. We received an invitation from civil society organizations to visit the city of Detroit, and we decided to do so between the 18th and the 20th today of October. This is an informal visit that we wanted to use to better, as Madoka was saying, understand the impact of water disconnections on human rights, in particular the rights that we are in charge of monitoring, housing, water and sanitation. We visited different parts of Detroit. We met with people whose water had been shut off, others whose water had not been shut off, but who are struggling to pay the water bills to avoid shut-offs. We listened to stories from single mothers, people with low income, older persons, persons with disabilities, persons with chronic diseases, and our conclusion is that you have here in Detroit a man-made perfect storm. What do we mean? This year alone, over 27,000 households were disconnected. And the number of, even though the disconnections are not new to this city, water disconnections are not new to this city, recently the numbers reached unprecedented levels. In addition, the water rates were increased by almost 9%, and this was all combined with a decreasing number of customers and an increasing unemployment rate, which makes the bills increasingly unaffordable. Without water, and you know that, people cannot live a life with dignity. They have no water to drink, to cook, to bath, to flush toilets, and to keep their clothes and their houses clean. The city doesn't have data on how many people have been and are living without tap water. This is a question that we have raised, let alone information on age, disability, chronic illness, race, income level of the affected population. The denial of access to a sufficient quantity of water threatens a wide range of human rights, not only the rights that we are in charge of monitoring, but also the right to life and the right to not to be discriminated against. It exacerbates inequalities, it stigmatizes people, and renders the most vulnerable even more helpless.
Can you speak into the mic in a minute? That's the one with
Sure, how's that? Yes? And bring it closer. I come closer. Well, you know, there's only so close I can get to this thing. I want to follow up on what Catarina just mentioned, this issue of discrimination. This is a key area of concern that we have. We are concerned that what's happening, the water shutoffs are having a disproportionate impact on low-income African-Americans in Detroit. And it doesn't surprise us in some ways, of course, because here we have a city, Detroit. Percentage of the population African-American, 80. Percentage of African-Americans living in poverty in this city, 40%. It doesn't surprise us, but we are deeply, deeply concerned. And we are concerned because African-Americans who are living in Detroit and facing water shutoffs are being asked to make impossible choices. Imagine you're choosing at times to either pay your rent or pay your water bill, pay for medical necessities or pay your water bill. These are not choices we expect people to have to make in one of the richest countries in the world, if not the richest country in the world. This is a serious situation. We are concerned with the stigmatization that the people who are facing water shutoffs are experiencing. A blue mark on the sidewalk announcing to the public, the neighborhood, your community, your friends, that you have an inability to pay. Stigmatization. Humiliation. We have been moved, however, by the people in Detroit in this struggle. We have been moved. They are resourceful. They are relying on neighbors, and neighbors are coming through. We wanted to underscore, however, the human rights implications and obligations here. The United States has ratified instruments, international human rights instruments, that commit the United States to ensuring everyone has the right to life and security of the person, that everyone should have access to housing and water in a non-discriminatory manner. The United States has ratified a convention that talks about the elimination of racial discrimination. In that instrument, the United States has said they are committed to ensuring no one experiences racial discrimination in the areas that we have seen are problematic here, housing and water.
When we talk about the human right to water and sanitation, which is a right that was explicitly and proudly recognized by the US government at the United Nations, this has a meaning. This has a very concrete meaning. It cannot be seen as an empty promise. And it does not mean the right to water and the right to sanitation does not mean that water has to be given for free. In the 3 days that we were here, nobody, even the poorest persons we met with, nobody asked us for free water. People want to pay their bills, they just want to pay their bills within their possibilities, within their incomes. They want affordable and fair bills. That's what people told us. And I've undertaken 15 country missions to different countries in the whole world, and I have to tell you that in many places of the globe, people want to have free water. This is not what the people in Detroit ask us. They want to pay, they know they have to contribute financially and pay their water bills. The only thing they want is justice and affordability. And I have to say this is in full conformity with what human rights mean. The human rights to water and sanitation mean that these services should be affordable, and they should not lead people to make impossible choices, as the ones Leilani was referring to, or force people to lower their consumption levels to a level that is below human necessities. If a mother tells me, I don't boil rice because I don't cook food that needs water and that makes water evaporate, then we have a problem. I don't flush the toilet because I cannot afford the water, then we have a problem. And we might have dire consequences in terms of public health, as you know. So about, we are talking about affordability, we are talking about quality, we are talking about accessibility. The water has to be available inside the household. And access has to be non-discriminatory. It cannot have a heavier impact on a certain group of people. And what we have seen during these 3 days is that it is having a heavier impact on poor people, in particular African Americans. These connections of water due to non-payment are only permissible if it can be shown that the resident is able to pay but is not paying. So the burden of proof is on the authorities that have to prove I disconnected, yes, but this person is rich or is able to pay the bill, just doesn't want for some random reasons. We met today with the mayor and city officials, and we are aware of measures that have been taken by the city in order to address the affordability, the water affordability issue. We are of the view that such initiatives are insufficient to ensure affordability of water and sanitation and adequate housing. The mayor's 10-point plan, for instance, does not seem to take into consideration the ability to pay of chronically low-income persons to pay their water bills and to pay the arrears. We want to also to put this visit in perspective. We knew the United States. Leilani's mandate and myself, we have been here on mission before to look at the whole situation, in my case, of access to water in the whole country. I knew that there were disconnections taking place in the US. I was in contact with civil society organizations. We received complaints. We wrote letters of allegation. We issued press statements. But I have to say that we were shocked, impressed by the proportions of the disconnections and by the way that it is affecting the weakest, the poorest, the most vulnerable, the people in the most difficult situations.
We have here, obviously, a water problem, but it's also a housing problem. And the standards that Catarina outlined for water around affordability are standards that equally apply under international human rights law to housing. In other words, housing must be affordable. So what happens when your water bill is unaffordable? It makes your housing unaffordable. We're concerned that the unaffordability has already led to and will lead to what we might call constructive eviction. In other words, no one's like, you know, wagging their finger and saying, get out necessarily, but with no running water, your house is deemed uninhabitable. It is an impossible living situation, and many tenants and residents may feel the need to leave. And when they leave, they are risking what? Homelessness. This is definitely of concern, and as I said, the affordability standard is a key standard with respect to the right to adequate housing. And so is security of tenure. It is a cornerstone. I mean, if you think about, you know, what makes your housing, what makes it feel good to come home? It's that feeling that you're not going to have to leave unexpectedly tomorrow. And with the water shut off, a whole lot of residents of Detroit do not have that feeling of security. We talk to residents who feel like they don't know how long they're going to be able to maintain their residence.
And before we move to some of the recommendations that we want to make, as I was saying, the human rights, they entail a package. So when you say right to water, right to housing, it entails affordability and quality and accessibility, etc. But it also entails non-discrimination, as we said, but also a right to information the right to justice, access to remedies. And this is another thing that we felt is missing in this case. We heard testimonies from residents about lack of information about the shutoffs, confusion regarding the water bills, and notices of unpaid bills. And we think that this lack of information and the lack of due process in the way some of the disconnections are undertaken leads to fear. So if you ask me what was the thing that impressed me more here, besides what I said before, it's the fear. People fear that their kids are taken away from them. People fear, because it's Sunday, that tomorrow, it's Monday, I can be disconnected. People fear when they open an envelope with a water bill, because it can be a similar amount to what I had last month, but it can be several times more. It's a constant fear people live with when it comes to the right to water and sanitation, which is connected to lack of information and also a lack of due process in dealing with disputes regarding your bills. So we have a set of recommendations. First, we suggest that the City of Detroit restores water connections to all residents unable to pay. And also, to residents unable to pay, and also to stop any further disconnections of water in those cases where residents are unable to pay, and provide them the opportunity to seek assistance. We also urge the city, the state, but also the national government, and I have to say this is a recommendation I addressed to the federal government in 2011, to adopt a mandatory affordability standard. In addition to this, because we think that this is not enough, the affordability standard is indispensable, but it will not help those in the most desperate situations. So in addition to the affordability standard, we think that specific policies should be adopted to ensure tailored measures and specific support to people who are in particularly vulnerable situations, including people in poverty. We also suggest the city to provide urgent measures, including financial assistance, to ensure access to essential water and sanitation, a minimum amount that is necessary for personal and domestic uses. I have it in liters because I'm European, sorry, which should be about 100 liters per person per day. I'm sorry, we should have converted, but I didn't. And in all those cases, the situation of the most vulnerable groups must be prioritized. We also recommend that the authorities make an urgent assessment of public health consequences for the individual, for schools and the community, of the water shutoffs, and take steps to mitigate any possible adverse impacts.
And I'll just end with a few more recommendations. One, that the appropriate authorities undertake an investigation into the water shutoffs to determine if they are having a disproportionate impact on African Americans and other groups protected against discrimination. With respect to some of those housing issues I raised, we recommend that governments, all levels of government, make every effort to ensure that the most vulnerable, including those who reside in Section 8 housing, are not evicted from or lose their housing as a result of water shutoffs or water bill arrears. And in the event that an individual or family is rendered homeless due to water shutoffs, the City of Detroit must have in place emergency services to ensure alternate accommodation with running water is available, and immediate and urgent steps must be taken to find long-term viable housing solutions for those residents. And I'm going to conclude with what is a really important recommendation. And it goes to the due process comments that Catarina made. It's a bit broader as well. In our view, the residents of Detroit should be ensured access to administrative and legal remedies. In particular, those who are unable to pay their current water bills and or arrears, or who want to challenge the amount of their water bills or the cutting off of their supply. These procedures must be made public and accessible and adequately resourced. In other words, if you have a dispute about a bill, you need an administrative remedy to that dispute. If you want to challenge the affordability of water in the City of Detroit, you need a legal mechanism to do that. Thank you.
Sorry if you didn't get the copy of the short press release, but there is also a link to a longer statement which explains more about their views and recommendations, and everything will be available online shortly, and so please be
bear with us.
Where?
It will be our website, but it will be widely distributed through New York, our media people, so I don't know how it works, but hopefully you will receive it. So can I take questions?
No, leave it there.
Yeah? No. Question back here, cuellodetroit.com. What levers do you have or that you can bring to bear to have the recommendations that you offer to court?
Should we take several?
Ms. Farha spoke of instruments that could be used to enforce this. Are you planning on taking action to enforce your views, or are you essentially seeking to shame Detroit into making a change?
If you travel around the world, I know that I've read that other countries have made it illegal to shut water off. Are you, would that be one of your recommendations?
United States make it illegal to shut water off? Yes. Sorry, just curious as to what the mayor's response was to your recommendations.
WBIB-TV. This puts a great deal of onus on a city that is already financially stretched. Who's going to pay for the water, and who's going to pay to make sure that they are policing people who can afford to pay and who will not pay? It seems like a lot of policing for a city that can't afford police on the street right now.
I didn't understand your question.
Wow.
So who's going to pay? The onus is putting the onus on the city. If you're trying to police people who are able to pay and are not willing to pay. So there's a lot more paperwork, there's a lot more bureaucracy. Who's going to pay for that in a city that can't afford that?
Monitor, not with policemen.
Okay.
Good. Monitor. Okay.
We didn't come here to shame anyone. We came here with a constructive approach to work with civil society and to work with the authorities. And as you know, we were received today by the mayor. If your question is, do we want to put pressure for this problem to be resolved? Yes, of course. But I think that it's not a negative approach of shaming. It's an approach of just saying there is a problem. This is a serious problem. This problem contravenes international human rights obligations that are binding on the US. We are here to help. Stay in touch with us. Let's continue the dialogue. And we, for example, in my own experience from the water side, I've visited many countries in the world. I have published a book which compiles good practices from the whole world. I just published, and I will launch it in two days in New York, a handbook on how to implement the rights to water and sanitation. I'm happy to share this knowledge. I'm happy to share these examples. I'm happy to help. That's what we are here for. Now, if you ask us, do we have any capacity to enforce? Do we come with blue helmets? No, we don't. We have as much powers as the UN member states gave us. And I always say this very cynically. The states that we are supposed to monitor are the ones who created us. Hence, we don't have more powers because we were not given more powers. So this is why it's for us so fundamental to work with civil society organizations, because they will be the ones who will ultimately be able to put pressure on government, but also with governments, because they are the ones who have the human rights obligations, and also with you, the press, because you are the ones that will make sure that our voices are heard. If I'm going to propose a complete prohibition on shutoffs, no, I've never done it in my life, and I will never do so. There are countries, I agree with you, that have such legislation, like, for example, England. In England, it is prohibited to shut the water off any person, even if that person has money. It was a choice based on potential health, public health impacts of lack of access to water. What I am calling for is a total prohibition of disconnections of people who cannot afford to pay and people who are in a especially vulnerable position. The mayor's response, he was very happy to receive us. We were very happy that he took the time to be with us. I think he listened to what we said, and we asked questions. And as I said, we hope to stay in touch, and we hope to receive further information on some of the questions that we raised. Financial stretch and who will pay. I'm not saying that the situation in this city is easy. That's not what I'm saying. But it is also true that when you look outside Detroit, and when you look, for example, at Southern Europe, and I have been receiving complaints from Southern Europe, from my own country, Portugal, Spain, Italy, and Greece, regarding shutoffs, this shows that the problem is not exclusive to Detroit. It's not Detroit. It's not exclusive to the U.S. So what does the government have to do? It has to make, if the city does not have enough money, then other levels of government have to step in to support. Because these are human rights obligations that are binding upon all levels of government, federal, state, and city. So if the city does not have the capacity, then others have to step in, because the US government at the federal level undertook certain human rights obligations, namely when it comes to non-discrimination, namely when it comes to housing, namely when it comes to water and sanitation. And also, you have to think of how you structure, and for that, I think that the city of Detroit and Detroit Water can talk with many actors throughout the world, and I'm happy to give suggestions, of how this has been solved. There are countries, cities in the world, which are much poorer than Detroit. And you find a way of charging more to those who can pay, charging more the commercial and the industrial users than the residential users, charge more those who have swimming pools and are using greater quantities of water, have a steep rise in tariffs. There are solutions. We don't need to reinvent the wheel here in Detroit. Now, it will cost money to monitor. Yes, it will cost money to monitor. It will cost money to make sure that we are being fair when we cut off. Yes, it's true, it costs money. But it is an obligation that this government has. And you cannot, yes, it costs money, but the injustice, I don't want to make the money argument because it irritates me. But because this is a question of rights, this is a question of dignity. But it costs, there are studies showing that for each dollar that you invest in water and sanitation, there are at least $9 of costs that you avert and of productivity that you gain. Because kids go to school, people go to work, you avoid a public health crisis. So even from the financial point of view, even if you are investing a little bit in certain areas as monitoring and whatever and subsidies, you are saving elsewhere.
Good point. Yeah.
I want to be able to take lots of questions, so I'll be short. No, everything you said. Ditto. But I'll just take up the issue that was raised around implementation. You know, I mean, this is a question that gets asked in every context about international human rights law. You know, does it have only shaming power? Is it enforceable? How can you enforce? You know what's so interesting about international human rights law is that it is actually very much about national law and what happens at the domestic level. So there's a way in which what we would like to see happen is for international human rights law and principles to be incorporated into every decision that's made around water and water shutoffs, in every policy, in every program, in every judicial decision, so that international human rights law, life is breathed into it through your domestic context, in your domestic context. That is where international human rights law is enforced, right? Not internationally. There are international mechanisms to ensure your governments remain in compliance with what they've signed and ratified, but where the action is back home. Absolutely, international law has to be brought back home. And if you think about the difference it would make, think about it. So a bunch of policymakers are sitting around a table in Detroit. You know, it's City Hall, we're just there. You know, it's a nice building, I like that building. So they're sitting around a table, think about it. And they're trying to figure out, what are we gonna do with this water, and we don't have any money, and oh no, and people aren't paying, some people are paying, it's unaffordable, blah, blah, blah. And then they pause and say, but wait, we have international human rights obligations, and one of those obligations is non-discrimination, another is the right to life and security of the person. We are dealing with people who have rights at stake. Stop the decision making and let's take their rights into consideration. It changes the entire nature of policy making, decision making, etc. So I just wanted to add that to the
Thank you.
Yeah, yeah. I'm Mike Elliott, 311 Local 551. There are commercial and industrial businesses and entities that are in arrears of their water bills. Did you all come up with any recommendations to address that issue?
Including
counties
and
corporations
that owe thousands and thousands of dollars.
Namaste.
State.
Geo
concept.
Can you answer my question, please?
No, we will. Yeah, we're going to take it.
Thank you.
How do you view the implementation of emergency management as it affects to the rights of the citizens of Detroit?
From media?
Yes.
Could you speak louder?
Yeah.
out to America. How can I know you've been with other. I know you've been.
We didn't know.
I didn't know you were from America. I know that you know, you've both been all over the world in other places. Can you talk a little bit about how this situation compares to other places where maybe the infrastructure isn't already built up yet?
Workers for those things. Judge Rhodes, in ruling on the case that was brought to stop the shutoff, essentially held that the, while acknowledging that the city had no plan to provide water to the poorest Detroiters, held that the balance of the of equities favored the creditors' concern about their getting paid on bonds held by the Water Department. How does that equation factor in from an international human rights perspective?
Question here, will you be taking your recommendations to the U.S. representative to the U.N. Susan Rice?
Yes, please, thank you. I'm Paige from Al-Jazeera Arabic. Are there any plans for a follow-up visit by yourselves or other U.N. officials?
My name is Bo, I'm the U.S. State Communications student. What will you all do if they don't adhere to what you have said, if they don't acknowledge what you said? They continue.
You want to
Regarding the question on other water users and the fact that they have arrears, well, my main focus is water for human consumption. So my recommendations were, and our recommendations, sorry, were all regarding affordability. That's my concern, of water for residential users. But we did ask the question. We asked for figures on the number of businesses that have water in arrears that have not paid. We asked for for the tariff structure for those users to compare it with the domestic users. And in human rights, what human rights says is that you have to implement rights according to available resources. The resources, for example, that are available here in the city. But there is a certain margin of flexibility that enables the city to expand its available resources. And one way to expand available resources is through what you were hinting at, making sure that the business pays more, making sure that the business is cut off in order to be forced to pay, so that we manage to have a system where there is a certain kind of cross-subsidization from the bigger consumers to the household, to the individual users. Comparing with other places, I've been to rich countries. Like Japan or Slovenia, where basically 99% of the population have access to water. I've been to poor countries where half of the population doesn't have access to water, or at least to the right to water. But what is new for me here in Detroit is the following. I've been to countries where people don't have access to water in large proportions because the country is in development, is a developing country. It does not have enough resources to ensure the progressive realization that I was referring to. But this large-scale retrogression or backward steps is something new for me, I have to tell you. It's new to see, and from a human rights perspective, any retrogression, any backward step should be seen as, in principle, a human right violation. And the burden of proof lies with the government to show that it is not a violation. Because if you have access and you lose access, in principle, your right is being violated. Yes, we are forwarding the recommendations to the U.S. Government, obviously. And we are continuing the dialogue with the U.S. government. Follow-up visit, maybe. We don't want to finish our work on Detroit today. We hope to continue in touch also with civil society organizations and to receive more complaints, more allegations, and also to stay in touch with the government. If they don't adhere, well, we will continue. We will continue. And if the government doesn't adhere, we will insist. What can I say? And then with regarding the issue of the emergency measures, emergency measures.
Manager.
Emergency measure management. Emergency management. The fact that the city is in such a situation doesn't exempt it from human rights obligations. It's just the law. So even if you are in an emergency situation as this city, the human rights obligations have primacy. Full stop. And if the city is not able to fulfill its obligations, well, as I said before, then other levels of government have to step in.
All right.
I think there was one, just to follow up on what Catarina said, you know, if you think about situations of conflict around the world, we still have expectations that human rights be upheld. And that is the same here, and I'm not likening the situation in Detroit to one of conflict, but only to say there is a thing called human rights primacy. And as Catarina said, in our world that's not special, but I understand that for you all it may very well be. In answer to the gentleman's question about the court case and as I said before, we would hope that all decisions taken reflect on the international human rights obligations of governments in the United States. And so when balancing the interests of creditors with the folks in Detroit who are unable to pay their water bills for lack of affordability, then the balancing that has to go on is around, okay, you've got these creditors, and I recognize that's a real problem in this city, there's no doubt about it, you're in bankruptcy, etc. But, we've got a whole group and class of people whose human rights are at stake. So, I mean, that's the kind of inclusion of international human rights principles that one would hope to see in decision-making of any sort. Thank you. Question?
Yes, I have one. Maureen Taylor, Michigan Welfare Rights. I've been told that you have been criticized for picking on the city of Detroit and that you are excluding everyone else and only focusing on water violations or mass shutoffs in this city. And I wonder if you take a moment to speak to that. And then the second issue is, I've also been told that it's been shared with you that turning water off in large numbers is not an uncommon practice.
Yes, I have.
That turning water off in large numbers is not an uncommon practice. And I wonder if you might speak to those two issues.
Yes, ma'am. Yes, ma'am. Tangela here is representing the community and residents of the Tri-County area. So I'm going to shut off. My question is, ma'am, you said that the actions is back home and the international actions have to be brought back home. So you're basically telling the residents that they have to stand up. So my question is, how do the citizens who have used democracy for so long stand up when democracy is not standing up for them? We have been robbed of our democracy, and that's what we as civilians are supposed to use to hold on to our rights. What do you say to the citizens of Detroit in that regard?
Is there anybody else from media? Yes?
Role for communication student at Wayne State. If you've already acknowledged that they are disproportionately targeting African Americans, this is indicative of the structural violence against African Americans in America that's been going on since, well, black people have been in America. And so, if they haven't done something in how many years? over 200 years that America's been a country. Over 200 years that America's been a country, they haven't done anything about the problem of race when there's structural violence and physical violence happening all the time. How do you expect them to actually respond to you all?
I wanted to ask you, in your travels, what is your experience on the question of privatizing water?
What my experience is?
Yes.
Rome, Adams, no Detroit. In court, Latimer has spoke up and said that the city is not contractually obligated to service the city's residents with water because the city is in bankruptcy. What I wanted to know is, contract law trump human rights.
Mark Allen, Michigan Coalition for Human Rights. As you said, Detroit's not the only municipality going through this issue. I personally met a woman from Pontiac yesterday who was experiencing the same issues with her water and has been for years. I was wondering if you had any words for other municipalities or any...
couldn't hear the question. You're wondering if...
Words for other municipalities.
Any words for other municipalities? Okay. I have contact information from a woman from Pontiac who's been experiencing similar problems.
So, please answer quickly because we are...
We're running out of time.
Okay, good. Okay, Lori, where is she?
Right here.
Yes, it is true that I was told that maybe I am just focusing randomly on Detroit. It's not random, number one, and I have focused already on the whole country. In 2011, I produced a report where I made recommendations to the federal government to set an affordability threshold?
Standard.
Because I had experienced the problem already in 2011. I was in California. I met with migrant women who were devoting 18% of their household income for water. I was in the Boston area. Also challenges with water shutoff. So I know it's not unique to Detroit. And it's not unique to the U.S. But the thing is, I dealt with a broader recommendation in 2011, and it is true that it were civil society organizations in Detroit that contacted me or contacted us and asked us to step in and to help because of the crisis here. And as I said before, the scale of the disconnections here in the city is unprecedented. It's different. It's different. The scale is different. What to tell citizens? It was your question. I'm sorry, but
we have lost our.
Yes. What do I tell you? I tell you that life is not easy. And I came here. If the problem was solved, we wouldn't have come here. We would have said, okay, problem solved. We came here because we know it's tough, it's difficult. And the only answer that I have is, don't give up. Continue. What can I say? And I have had good examples in the past. For example, when we went to California with Patricia Jones, we were pushing for the adoption of a human right to water and sanitation bill. That recommendation at the end of my mission. Eventually it got adopted. So I think we cannot give in. We have to be stronger than the adversity that we face. Privatizing, yes, I've come across many instances. I don't know what you want me to say. Countries where it is forbidden to involve the private sector. Countries where the private sector has been involved. Countries where it works well. Countries where it works very badly. What is fundamental in any case is to remind ourselves that the human rights obligations stay with the government. Even if the government decides to delegate whatever to the private sector, the obligations lie with the government. And if we want to hold somebody accountable, it's the government.
Thank you. That's right.
Thank you. How did we get here in the first place?
I think that's all.
On the comment about democracy,
I think that's a very good question. And I think the way I view democracy is that it is a precious and fragile thing. And what you're experiencing, and you will have experienced this previously, is democracy not working, potentially. And if that's how you're feeling and that's what your experience is, then you need to figure out how you're going to protect democracy. So I leave it to the people of Detroit to figure out how they're going to do that. But democracy is a fragile thing, obviously, and you know, deserving of protection.
What recommendations do you give to the people of Detroit?
No, sorry, I'm going to just answer the question. The gentleman with the historical thing, I mean, I can only say you have a very intact and analytical analysis. I don't have an answer to that. It was more of a comment than it was a question, I feel. And just going back to, have we singled out Detroit, I echo what Catarina said, you know, the scale, but also our job is to monitor human rights globally. Well, what are human rights about? It is about protecting the most vulnerable. And what we saw before we got here, and underscored when we got here, was massive shutoffs and a particularly vulnerable population, because you have the highest rates of poverty as a city in the country. So of course we were particularly concerned with Detroit, because we're human rights lawyers and we're concerned with vulnerable populations and large scale shutoffs. Thanks.
Thank you very much, David. Sorry, we have to finish. Thank you very much for coming, and thank you very much for your
Thank you.